is it what Chrissy or Tom Chrissy? Or what type of Chrissy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, trading looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said, oh, help
on
me.
Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we'll bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
Welcome back and thanks for joining us. Like I said, I got the full compliment of my guest, Emmanuel Chukwuemeka, the reverend gentleman and the social commentator is still here with me. And the fiery activist and legal practitioner Abbas Ahmed is here with me. Abbas, nice to see you again.
Thank you.
Looking radiant, huh? And making the Lord have Abbas like mine. All right. We're looking at a very critical issue in the socio-political engineering of the Nigerian nation. And a lot of people, those of us who are students of history or political science, being apprised with the knowledge of how party-based politics was played in the First Republic, or even pre-independence time by the founding, some people argue that you don't have founding fathers of Nigeria, but the likes of Dr. Herbert Macaulay, Nnamdi Azikiwe, Chief Obafemi Awolowo, Sir Ahmadu Bello, you cannot but even mention Tafar Balewa, Okoti Ebo, and the others, that the kind of politics they played then, even though it was cut across maybe ethnic or regional groups, was ideologically based. What has gone wrong? Nigerians or the Nigerian politician is not learning from history. Abbas, maybe you want to kick the ball rolling.
Thank you. I think as a student of history, I'm taken aback sometimes because for the founding fathers, I think the major goal before them was to drive away the colonial masters.
Mm.
So foundationally, I think the contraption called Nigeria, there was a foundational problem in the sense that there was no set objective as to what do we intend to achieve after power. That was why as early as 6 years later, apart from the first set of political leaders, the Awolowo, the Azikiwe, and all the rest of them, 6 years down the line, I want you to go and look at the speech of Chukwuma, Cardinal Nziogu, as to why they toppled the civilian government. And if you look at the factors he enumerated, the factors are still with us today. It has not changed. Corruption personified, 10%. Evil service, like one retired permanent director said. He said he told us in a board meeting. He said, "We are not civil servants. He said we are evil servants." Yeah, I know my people very well. He said we are evil servants, not civil servants, because it's monumentally corrupt. So what am I saying? Foundationally, there is no set objective, and even in the life of a man, if you do not define your objective in life, you are going to be subjected to the circumstances that you find yourself in. That's why immediately after, okay, the colonial masters were driven away, ethnicity set in. So most times today now, you see everybody is angling for people from my region to become the president, not necessarily because of what they have to offer this nation, but because it's an opportunity to bring the national cake to this
closer
part. The Niger Delta clamored for, we want a southerner, we want a south southerner, we want a south southerner. It got there. The honest truth with that, the major players in that regime were southerners, people from the south, because each ethnic group, now Buhari is there. The honest truth is that the major players are also, he was being accused of northernizing his appointments, the major appointees, majorly. Northerners are playing critical role. and things like that. So for me, I think there was a foundational problem that we did not define our objective from inception, and that is where we are today, because there was no basis for even our relationship. I keep saying it everywhere I go. I listen as a student of Nigerian history, as a young man who has grown, born in this country, grew up in this country. Our relationship as a nation is faulty, and except we redefine the basis of that relationship, we won't go very far.
Okay, Emmanuel, you want to take it up from where Abbas, has shut off, and he's saying that the country had a faulty relationship, foundation in its socio-political engineering, and probably that's why it's not getting it right. But we're talking, when you talk politics, would you want to bring morality into it? Is it just the individual? What is integrous about, such an association?
Now, when you cannot divorce morality and value from leadership and administration. Now, if a leader and a group of people lack sense of value, they don't know exactly why they are existing. And then secondly, they lack moral. Moral is ability to define and run on good things, good natural principle, ethics that are acceptable worldwide. If they lack this, then definitely whether the foundation is right or wrong, we'll still be getting chaos in the system. Exactly. And that is why we notice that definitely people will move from one end to the other, and then they come again, the same manifesto, they come again, the same group of people, singing a different tune every 4 years, because values are not defined.
Okay, gentlemen, let's just quickly take some snippets of the major defection yesterday that were seen back and forth of a political titan, in his own right, a former governor of Ogun State, former managing director of the Daily Times of yore, Chief Olusegun Osoba. Let's watch the video again. We've been able to put something together so that our viewers too can form their own, opinion or judgment on this.
Come back, please. Hello.
Of my back, if he cool, he did not kill me.
I'm
a poor body. I was going to Shoko. So this is the governor of the state of my back. So yeah, I'll blow you.
Hey, we're in a position now.
How are you?
We met today at the residence of Akirogun Osoba, Daremo, and I've resolved all the differences within the leadership completely. And as such, we're happy to tell the world that the leadership of progressive politics in the western part of Nigeria is united and ready to jointly prosecute the agenda for growth, purposeful leadership, development, good governance in the western part of Nigeria as we are committed to doing that for the entire nation, Nigeria, and through that support the effort at the national level to revive the Nigerian economy and put the people of Nigeria in a better stead than we inherited when our party took over the governance of Nigeria. A time was when Aremu Olusegun Osuba switched to another party. He was a foundation member of the APC, and he was in the APC throughout my election. If you care to know, I need to be that corporation. Yes, it was for a time with the SDP. And with what we have just done today, Akinrogun Osuba, the Aremu himself, is back with the progressive leadership of Yoruba Barrister. Progressive leadership is on the platform of all Progressives Congress, if you care to know.
Ori ayo la o ma ko alelu, that's how it was political anthem. Photo journalist.
Yes. My happiness is very personal to me, but the joy of very crucial is for us forging a one front and remain in a progressive party. I'm on apologetic progressive, and I will remain progressively patrician, and that is the only philosophy, principle, and my belief. So, wherever the progressive must unite with their vision, I am for it. Governor of Ogun State is selected on the platform of APC. He remains APC and is for APC. And we can vouch for them. This is not a leaderless revolution.
All right, that's some snippets of the event yesterday, just to signpost the issue of political carpet crossing, which is becoming very endemic in the country now. Yes, we saw that in the first and even in the second republic. Even in the second republic, when the NPP had the alliance with the then MPN, the alliance was broken, but some of the NPP people who were already in the federal cabinet refused to go with their leader. Are we seeing such a thing playing out now, or can you pigeonhole needs to be the people at carpet crossing because they want better access to power and the spoils of office?
If I may say, basically, it is expected that political parties should have aims, objectives that border on ideology. Now, this is what we're after. This is how we're going to rule these people. This is how we're going to manage the governance. Now, we have often seen that aside any other thing, that people could just move from one party A to party B. Now, the reasons are diverse. Some people could go because, yes, they want whatever you call it, share of the spoils. Share of the spoils. They want a better opportunity. Some will also want security. Now, maybe that as it may, this thing is becoming too rampant now. And we have to look out about institutionalizing or building up institutions that will re-educate the people on structures of a political party, instead of just allowing every man, every woman to come in there, whoever has the highest money, he gets in there, and then whoever you think you can use for to win election in a region, you call that person and say, come into our party. Maybe standing on the lawyer here, Abbas, we know that the constitution allows for, you know, freedom of association. Yes, but freedom of association when we are talking of what is the moral background for that association? You know, what do you want to do? Who are you serving? Your personal interest or the interest of the people? You know, we still have a long way to go. We still have a long way to go. And that makes the governance a little bit difficult. Because the very moment somebody sits with you today to discuss an issue, he defects or he, whatever they, I saw with due respect, the governor of Osun saying that, you know, he moved out or he used one soft language. But moving out, cross-carpeting, jumping ship, all of them are the same thing. Now, there are issues that have been discussed 2 or 3 weeks. If you leave and come back in next 2 weeks. So how do we recall back those issues? At what point do we welcome you? Now, these are issues that keep drawing even the nation back in policy making, and it has to be addressed.
Okay, let me come to Abbas Ahmed. Abbas, taking off from what he said, can you legislate political association or what association an individual, you know, would want to belong to and the rest? But does it make such a situation seen as, in quotes, political prostitution?
Well, constitutionally, every man in Nigeria is guaranteed freedom of association. Even in the United States of America, where we borrowed our democracy from, we've seen Donald Trump being a Democrat before coming back to become a Republican, and vice versa. The only challenge is, what is the objective? Let me just give a typical example. Colin Powell is a Republican. But in the course of the campaign between Barack Obama and McCain, he said something publicly that he was going to vote Barack Obama, a Democrat, because he sees him as a rallying point and not a divisive personality. That he sees him more of a transformational leader than a divisive leader. That's principle. That even though I'm Republican, but in this particular election, I want a leader, because we're already fragmented. I need a leader that will unite more than dividing the nation. Those are principles. But unfortunately, in this part of our world, most times I told somebody, I'm going to say it, I wish the future would prove me wrong. I said, any party that lose at the national level in this nation, let me tell you what will happen. It will take the grace of God for that party to come back, because the politicians will not be patient for 4 years to rebuild that party and win the confidence of the people to win a national election again. They would have filtered into all nooks and crannies of the existing political structure, because most of our politicians are professional politicians. They don't have any other job they are doing. So being unemployed for 4 years will be on their part, will be insanity of the highest order. So what they are going to do, it doesn't matter, because their survival has always been their main objective in politics. They don't have any ideology. There is nothing that brings them together ideologically in terms of, oh, this is what we are going for. Like, you see, when Barack Obama and, was it Mitt Romney, were debating, Obama was saying, those whom this nation has given the opportunity to make so much wealth should be taxed more to create more opportunities for others. And the debate on the other side was, well, if you are asking those who have succeeded to pay more tax, you are simply punishing success. That means you are saying it is an offense for me to be successful. You see the ideological, you see the debate. Mm-hmm. Now, most times in Nigeria, you don't see such. But those who believe that, I think, those who are rich in this country should be able to pay more so that we can create more wealth for everybody. One day, that's why Barack Obama was given the presidency twice. That's ideological argument. Now, in Nigeria, you don't have anything like that. The binding factor is, how do we share the national patrimony? And I tell you, once they lose that opportunity, they come back to ask themselves, where is the next cake being baked? And that's why I can tell you, the possibility, I'm sorry to say, I'm not, the possibility of PDP, I'm telling you, because by next 4 years, I can tell you, it will be the carcass of the party that will be left. Because they can't wait. They don't have any other way of surviving. They've survived in politics, and you are asking them to be unemployed for 4 solid years.
But people
who have access to free funds and all the rest of them. So I'm only saying that, look, in this part of decline, yes, there's no ideology. So people flow. For that or for Shoba, I can tell you categorically, I saw it coming, because the issues were just about, this is how things should be run in Ogun State, between him and the governor, how his men in government were treated.
So personality issues could.
Yes.
Could derail an ideological movement.
Correct. That is most.
Because what Aregbesola was saying there, the governor of Osun State, is that the progressives in the West is united, and you want to kind of interlope it with what is happening in the North now. Kwakwanso, Buhari, and Saraki. Does it mean that the North is already, which is already plotting the fall of its own, even from within the same party?
You know, even the.
I want you to try and marry this, because they're all progressives now, but you have conservatives into progressives and the rest. So you have that kind of diffusion.
It was a marriage of convenience. The honest truth is that there are some people in APC today that are hardcore conservatives. I'm a student of Nigerian politics. I can pinpoint many members of APC today,
it will be no harm,
that do not subscribe, and by even in their widest imagination or even dream, are not progressive in nature. They are core conservative. They are, so it's the whole issue was, we need to get somebody out of the system, get him out of the way. So people from different backgrounds came together and say, look, our objective is this. Let's even achieve our core objective. Then we'll come back and look at our differences. That's exactly what is happening. So it's not as if from inception, they subscribe to progressive ideology. That's why they are in APC. It's a contractor. There was a set objective to say, look, we need to get somebody out of the system. Let's get him out. So people, of course, Rotimi said, when Ashwaji was celebrating his 64th birthday, acknowledged the fact Tinubu played in rallying the dissident in PDP.
That's the President Muhammadu Buhari.
Yes. Yeah. No, even Amechi said it.
Yeah.
That Tinubu played a pivotal role in being able to rally those that were aggrieved with PDP.
Mm.
You know, he made several trips to Port Harcourt to, you know, sway them to come over. And all the rest. Why? Because there was a division. There was a problem in PDP. And he saw the opportunity. And as a strategist, he actually took advantage of that, you know, opportunities and brought them in. And they formed a coalition that, not because ideologically they all belong to the school, same school of thought. Ordinarily, you see the problem that Saraki is actually going through in the Senate. If you believe in an ideology, party supremacy, if your party says we are going right, you don't have, it's just like, it's treason in the military when the commander says turn right and you are turning left. So the party said these are the people we want in certain political structures of the Senate. You look at them in the eyes and say, well, to hell with you. I have my own clear-cut idea. It doesn't happen when the party is supreme and you believe in the ideology of that party. You will fall in line with whatever the party says. So that's the division that we are now seeing. Differences. Most times, people are already scheming for 2019. And so they are already looking at, look, if you allow this person to occupy this post, it means that 2019 is actually certain. And how do we sabotage that effort and things like that? You know, it's the
politics. That is what is playing out gradually now.
Gradually, yes.
Okay. We'll come to that, gentlemen. Let's take a short break and bring you one or two messages. And when we return, we'll continue with our discussion. Join us again.
For topical issues, Nigerians must have something to say.
Arms. We don't need arms for anything. Help them put it into education.
They need to buy another arms now.
What are they fighting for?
Who? Government should deal with them. Squarely.
Please help us bring back our girls.
No money, no markets. We are dying. Everybody is crying. Nothing, nothing.
Any man God support, no man stops.
It's a prophecy I believe he must have received from heaven. Yes.
The people giving voice to the voiceless.
Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on Digi 360.
2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you come? Will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down. Explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.
Core TV News now live on all Androids.
Welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
Download Core TV News app from your Play Store. Click on the menu to see all our top stories. From politics, sports, business, foreign news, and live TV to watch us live on your mobile.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
You can also click on video to see all our YouTube videos. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station. You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.
Chrissy, or Tom Chrissy, or what type of Chrissy is that? Except Chrissy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, tribal looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is, that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said to hell
on Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
To Core TV, and you're watching Core Digest. Our topic today is defection of party faithful. Is it the trend of change? I said I was going to, let me come to you, Emmanuel, that some of the party persons or the politicians, let's put it, whether at foundation member or those who joined midway and the rest, some have had cause to complain that it is the issue of access to power, you know, not just the access to power, rather, that it could, it's an escape from political oppression or persecution, and some see it as a tactical or strategic political retreat to either relaunch themselves or their followers in the march to arresting political power. So do you see truism in the fact of political oppression and persecution?
Yeah, exactly. In one aspect, why? Because we have a kind of mentality in our nation polity, the winner takes all, the aggressive political warfare, we see it as that is even a physical combat. Go to programs, we go for election with what's it called?
Even guns, arms and ammunition,
for an ordinary election. And so now, if somebody loses out, the next thing is that the opposition will want to deal with him, vendetta. So the issue of vendetta, when you have gangsterism, when you have political cliques whose operation are not defined and guided by ideological principles, it will surely be inevitable. And so for somebody who has no strength to fight back, he may decide to say, oh, I surrender, then let me just join you people, and then I'll be attending your meeting, I will not talk until the next time. And so he can announce, I've come back to the party. Now, you know, there are issues. There are some of recently, there were some of these guys that their names were mentioned of having received some amount from, you know, for the arms deal. I don't want to mention some names here now. So now, instead of trying to stand in and facing and saying, I received this money for so-so, some will even decide to leave a particular denomination in church, change their denomination, remarry, change their political party. You know, I believe that there is no other way to define this and to avoid what? Avoid prosecution and avoid intimidation. And so it goes that way. It's a really sorry sight. And we have to stand up to it. Unfortunately, very, very unfortunately, we are not building even the political strategies now. Like my learned friend here said, there are people that are clever at gathering people. Now, but what they forget to do and what they are not doing is trying to leave a lasting legacy. We need to build an institution that will define those things. We are the policemen, we are the government agencies, we stand up to their responsibility that if somebody is victimized, he can report to the law court. Now, but if you don't have enough money and you walk up to the law court to enforce your right, men, you might find yourself in deep trouble, deeper trouble than, you know, trying to fight for your right. And so if jumping and shifting this will be the best thing, then the politician will say, okay, that's a better option. Let me secure the 100 million naira I've just received now, and then I'll fight. He who lives to who fights and runs away lives to fight another day. So he jumps ship.
Okay, but Abbas, okay, you want to make some statement here before I ask you the next question? Okay,
I sat down sometimes and I look at our political quagmire, and I was asking myself, why do we have this kind of political nature in Nigeria?
Wow.
I've come to realize one thing, that you see, government is the greatest dispenser of even the fundamental services in this country that everybody seeks political connection. Because if you don't have political connection, even to get passport, I'm just as basic as passport is, something that
which is constitutionally guaranteed.
To be able to walk into a passport office and the passport officers will look at you with respect and dignity, give you a chair to sit,
national identity,
give you a glass of water to sip while they capture your data, and come with honor and dignity to hand over your document. If you see the commercial transaction that goes in getting a passport for an average Nigeria, go to the passport office in any part of this country, you will discover how we have been dehumanized. You go to the road, see how the police will arrest a woman that has just gone to Mile 12 to buy charcoal, probably going to somewhere in Ikorodu to go and sell a charcoal to make a living.
What would the police be arrested her for? Deforestation?
See, I don't know. So what I'm trying to say, in essence is that you discover that from the top to the bottom, everybody, including the politicians, because once a politician loses out, he knows that for him to live a good life within that next 4 years, he simply needs to go to where it is happening. Apart from that, the fear also of being victimized by the other party, like you rightly said, a winner takes all situation, where we see each other as enemies. But because you have defeated me in an election, I'm automatically your enemy. I can go after your business empire. I can go after your family member. If you are not even careful, your children that are in government school, I can decide to say, someone, you know, we are so petty.
They close the banks overnight.
So, are you getting my point? So petty. The large-heartedness to admit that we can have differences in our opinion does not necessarily mean we are enemies. I may not see, for example, if somebody said, PDP performed very well. Somebody said, no, PDP didn't perform well. It's a matter of perspective, because on the same lane, somebody could be traveling 100 kilometers per second, and somebody would say, that's slow for me. And we'll hunt for you to say, excuse me, I'm heading for an emergency meeting, clear off the road, and let me go at 150 kilometers if it's permitted. It's a matter of perspective. There could be somebody that said, look, slow and steady. But somebody could say, no, I want to be faster. So the issue of, you know, this, our politics, the challenge we are having is that we need to mature for people to know that, look, we can disagree on matters of principle without necessarily being enemy. And we should not use the apparatus of state to oppress and victimize. Are you getting my point? I do not subscribe to corruption, but sometimes I tell law enforcement officers, in trying to do your job, you should also do it within the ambit of the law, as an image maker of the government, because you can actually be doing a right thing in the wrong way, and it will defeat the entire purpose. Yeah. That's just some of the challenges that we are having.
Another challenge that people would want to point to is that the defection back and forth, you know, leaves the voter no choice. What choice does it really leave the voter, Abbas?
You see, in all this...
I ask this question with respect to having independent candidates. Would that help in stabilizing, you know, political parties in Nigeria and its ideology? Would it help in building it?
Well, maybe in our present state of political development, yes, we can introduce the option of independent candidacy to give people options, But even in America, where they have the question you want to ask yourself, how many of them in the history of the entire America have been able to single-handedly
win
an election? Because you need structure. You need massive structure. Even in America, let me say this, I said it on a particular phrase, even in America, election is very expensive. Very expensive. You spend hundreds of millions of dollars to get to an office that you will not even earn one-tenth of the fraction of what you have spent. But in that climb, they understand the objective of public service. Public service is that, look, I want a bigger platform to be able to impact people's life. It's not an avenue for me to make money. But here we invest in politics. And want
to recoup.
That is election in any part of the world. Adverts, billboards, using aircraft to run around the whole of United States of America. Sure. It's not a cheap affair. Okay, Barack Obama ran the most expensive presidential election in the but his salary is not commensurate with what he spent in there. So the what you spend is quite different from what you are going to achieve there. You can spend all the billions.
It's not even him spending the money.
The public.
It's the public. Those who believe in the party ideology, who empathize with these directions.
Yes. But you know, there is a system. That's why the issue of structures, the issue of system, the issue of processes in this part of the world. He generated so much, and the system is so scientific in monitoring the expenditure that you cannot say, because you generated $1 billion
you
in
must
US,
spend the whole
therefore
billion.
It is your personal money.
No,
but here, what they do is that raise money billions, and the presidential candidate can just sit down and say, okay, my wife, take this 200 million naira into your account, my junior brother, take this 50 million naira, and nothing happens. Nothing happens. So that's part of the corruption. Yeah, everywhere, all over the world, election is expensive. But the question is, why are you going into public office? To serve the people, not to make money. But in Nigeria today, the biggest business is politics. You want to be a multi-billionaire, all you need to do is just join any political party and contest an election. Win any election as a governor.
Isn't that why we have the do or die?
Correct, because the benefit attached illegally and criminally to those offices are mind-boggling. The institutions are too weak. The pockets, the legislative houses of each of the states are in the pocket of the governor.
Yes, I was going to ask you as a lawyer, yes, how do we, you know, redress this kind of imbalance? Because I asked the question, which you're still here to answer yes. about the choice it leaves the voters.
Yes. See, you know, it was about, I think about 3-4 days ago, I was on a platform and I was people were talking about institutions and all the rest of it. I've come to the conclusion there are institutions even in this country, but most times the average Nigerian is too quick to succumb to the intimidation of those institutions. We unconsciously compromise those institutions. Most Nigerians, as educated as we are, sir, go to the road and ask how many of them have all their vehicle particulars intact. Many, even as educated as we call ourselves. You go to the road, most drivers, private drivers, some of them, they don't have particulars. They have expired driving licenses. And once a federal road safety officer flags you down and sees one loophole, the next thing you begin to see them say, "Oga, I'm sorry, so what can we do now?" And not the rest of them. And what you do, each time you compromise those institutions, like rightly said,
destroying them.
The values, the ethical values we adhere to are the pillars of every society. Once you compromise those values and those ethics, it's like building, it's like erecting the pillar of a house with ordinary sand. It's a question of time if it collapse. How many lawyers, sometimes I say it in the public, 90% of our lawyers will have clients in police custody, and the police will have the authority to look at the lawyer and say, go and discuss with your clients. And what it means is that go and negotiate bail. And lawyers will go to their clients, collect money from their clients and share with the police. Sometimes I weep. I've had to ask a police officer in Lyons building who said I should go and discuss with my client. I said, "I don't understand. Explain." He said, "What do you bring for us?" I said, "What?" He said, "What do you bring for money?" I said, "If I give you money, which pocket will you put it?" I said, "You stink. You stink. You are irritating me. Is that how to be a police officer?" And right here you say bail is free. If we go to the media to say the police is corrupt, you say we are lying against you. Right in Lyons building, I saw the DCO and I told her, I said, "A woman, I taught you to have meek of compassion in your heart. That a man has been detained here for the past 3-4 days. If you have a case against him, charge him to court. And you had the authority to tell your IPO to collect money from me." She said, I didn't ask him to collect. I said, "I thought you'd be courageous enough as a police officer to admit that you sent an IPO, but I know no IPO will have the authority to ask people for money without the connivance of the DCO or the DPO." I say there's no police station you go to in Nigeria today that police officers don't collect money. If there is any, let them bring them to the TV station. I will tell him I can bring people that will give evidence
who have passed through such
this thing. He said, "Like, so what I'm trying to say, sir, the institutions are there. Nigerians must be courageous enough sometimes to look at them in the eyes. Say, you were established to do certain things. The president can't be everywhere. We need to engage in this fight." About 3 weeks ago, about a month ago, I was at the airport. I was on my way to Abuja. A flight of 10 o'clock was scheduled till almost 2 o'clock to 12 o'clock to 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock to 4 o'clock.
No compensation.
No compensation.
But,
no.
but if you miss that flight and you want to take another one, you're charged.
Yeah. If you don't show up.
Yeah, if you don't show up.
I had to mobilize the people in the airport. I said, "For God's sake, how long will we keep on taking nonsense?" I took them down, requested for the police officer in charge of MM2. I said, "We are not hooligans. We are Nigerians. We deserve to be treated fairly. We pay for these services. Even if there's anything wrong, we need to be told, to be communicated." I said, "I want you to be a living witness. We are not going to be violent, but I need explanation from the management." They were running head task. I said, "I will hold this desk." In fact, they were still selling tickets. Even when, four flights, they've reshared. They were still selling. So I had to go to the desk. I said, "Excuse me, as fellow Nigerians, you are not going anywhere. Because those people who bought their tickets from 10 o'clock by 4, we are still on ground. So except you want to travel by 12 o'clock, they are deceiving you." And I told the counter guys, I said, "Why are you people being criminal? This is immoral. Your aircraft does not even have one single liter of fuel. You are still scouting for fuel and yet you are selling tickets to people." I said, "What kind of trauma are you putting people to?" Until the manager was for, because I told the DPO, I said, "You must bring down that man to come and explain to us what's happening." They brought the man down only for him to confess that of their 4-5 aircraft on ground, there's no single fuel in any of the aircraft.
Then why do you
sell tickets?
Why we were busy?
Supposed to.
Are you getting it? Why we're busy? I said, I don't have any problem with you having problem and challenge, yeah. But communicate to your customers. I wish a management staff could come to the passenger lounge to constantly interface with us and say, look, honestly, I'm looking for fuel. Please bear with me. I said, but then you should stop selling tickets. Because you are not even sure whether any of your aircraft is going to leave. So people will pay now. Who ought to be in Abuja? You will now reschedule them for the following day. I said, that's criminal. That's not how you are just exploiting us because we do not have strong institutions that will make you to pay compensation.
Yeah.
Consumer Protection Council.
Yeah.
I wonder what they are doing. I had to call a fan officer that was following up on following us.
No, they'll tell you they don't have.
I look at the woman and I said, do you know this particular airline? This has been a tradition.
Mm-hmm.
A tradition. Everybody knows. In fact, I mistakenly bought their ticket.
I'm sure I know that. I'm sure I know that airline, but I don't fly them anymore.
Why were
no, don't mention the name. I don't fly them.
The Minister for Transport came in to MM2. And I walk up to him. I say, sir, we have a challenge here. These are issues that as ministers, you should help us to look into. An airline should not be selling tickets when they know they are not going to fly. That's part of it. That's his reaction was, it's another discussion for another day.
That's what he said.
No, he didn't even say. He said these people, they always have problems. And he walked away.
And that's it.
And that was
the minister of the federal.
Yes.
Now, but before even the matter gets to a minister, assuming we have to digress a bit,
don't let us digress. Once you can situate it within the ambit of what we are discussing,
exactly.
There should be a monitoring body
to see to the effect. It's like the airport is a security area to the nation. And so when you have such things on ground, you already living, you're making the nation vulnerable and porous to attack. So back to what we are saying.
Emmanuel, let me quickly at this juncture invite teaming viewers within and outside Nigeria to join us on discussion today. Defection of party faithful. Is it the trend of change? Call us on 0816-481-8001. And for the unsighted, you can reach us on 0816-481-8001. Yeah, let's continue.
Right. Now, you asked...
For me, particularly, let's return to our issue here. Right. Because it's the issue of institutions are there, but we are not enforcing those institutional idiosyncrasies that will make for a better society.
I want to recommend that Nigeria should, the NOA, Orientation Agency, should begin to educate the masses, the populace. I just want to recommend that you educate the populace. Watch any man that jumps from one political party to the other. Simply means he lacks value, he's afraid of himself, he's afraid of the situation, and he can't be our mouthpiece.
Okay.
Because if he's afraid of being victimized, how will he then stand for me when I'm being victimized?
Okay, let's quickly go to Benin, the capital of Edo State, and Ahmed, that's your own state, and join Ogbeifun. Good morning, Ogbeifun.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, nice having you on our program. What do you think about these political cross-carpeting and the rest?
Thank you a lot. Thank you so much, sir. But I think I will a little bit divert away from that area because of it was just a comment that one of your guests just make mention of.
Must be the airport incident.
Saying that most of the drivers don't have a driver's license, and when road safety find them, the people will road safety. But I want to put it to him that this issue is the problem from the so-called road safety. I happen to be a...
Yeah, so sorry, dear Ogbeifun, you're off cuff. What Abbas did was just to signpost that situation with political or lack of political ideology, actually. So it's not the road safety issue we are discussing here. So look, let us look at the issue of choice, and you are raising that the National Orientation Agency should be revitalized, re-energized, brought back to life to really carry out its campaign issues to Nigerians?
The NOA, the National Orientation Agency, by religious bodies, by various institutions, should begin to educate us, the masses, the populace, that watch out for men that lack integrity. Watch out also for men that lack the ability to stand in the face of opposition. Now, because if you say you jump, you move from one party to another because you are afraid of being victimized, then how can you stand for an ordinary person when that person is being victimized? So you do not possess the quality of a leader if you cannot stake your head or neck to say, I will defend and I will speak to the last. Now, we should also say, watch out for a man who has not given you details of how he's going to run this nation. Now, we have seen campaign promises being thrown open. You know, I wouldn't want to also mention some various ones that even at the end, in our glaring eyes, somebody got up and said, no, I didn't say that. Now, he didn't say it. The party said it. And so we said these things and we buy the people over.
I'm sure you're talking about the 5,000 naira stipend to unemployed Nigerians.
Is that the only promise that we have seen?
go on and say it. I mean, without
5,000 naira. And realistically speaking, what is 5,000 naira within 30 days?
That's why the government is reneged, or the president said
it's not realistic. It's not money. It's not anything to go by.
Yeah.
Now look at the issue of the, if you check what 5,000 naira is with regards to the exchange rate of dollars, now you know that is not money. Now why will you even give 5,000 naira to somebody, assuming that's even the issue, when we could invest the 5,000 naira in multiple forms and then get our people employed?
How much ordinarily does the politician, you know, gives to the voting population, to the voter? Because Abbas, you want to come in there. I know you have some political leanings too, you know, apart from your right and legal this thing, that even the voter is compromised because of his asphyxiated position, and the politician will always cash in on that. Voters' education is poor. He's mentioned that. How about historicity to understanding such nomenclature? Before you answer, let's go to Mina, where one of our regular callers, Zumba, is calling from in Niger State. Good morning, Umba. Hello, good morning.
Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning.
Okay, thank you very much, Umba. Yeah, tell us, what are your...
Thank you very much. The discussion that you are discussing about defection into one party to another is something that has been a problem in Nigeria. But the grassroots, the bottom line, is that we have lived what we're supposed to do in terms of the former president that passed. The former president that passed tried to reconcile the whole nation. He tried to seek the minds of the whole area and the whole zone. But it wasn't possible. Now he has failed the election. We have come back to regional power. Regional power which always brings problems. Regional power is not what we are talking about. What we are talking about is reconciliation from both sides of the region. If we can go back to the drawing board of the constitution, we have to go for reform constitution, constitutional conference. And these are the same people who say no constitutional conference. Now
there are the people. All right, Umba from Niger State. Well, he's bringing up the issue of the constitutional conference, or true, what the progressives call it then. But the question I've asked is the issue of the voter, the politician, the compromise, and the lack of political education, no historical or empirical statistics for even the voter of today to know. History, again, has been scrapped from our educational curriculum.
I'm going to speak on just two issues that I'm trying to draw out there. Number one, voters education. Once a man is poor, survival becomes the first priority. In a situation where people live below poverty line, where 1,000 naira that you think is nothing, I tell you, in some villages and some remote areas, to some people who don't have skill, don't have education at all, 1,000 naira to them, taking it to the market to buy a loaf of bread, 200 naira out of the 1,000, the family will share it for the next 2, 3, 4 days. 1,000 naira is a lot to them. In that kind of situation, except you structurally address the issue of poverty, politics will continue to be a game.
Of money.
When you empower people, their capacity to make rational decisions is enhanced and fortified. But once a man is hungry, rationality
is secondary.
A man has children's school fees to pay, doesn't even know where the school fees is going to come from. And somebody, a politician, calls him and says, look, take 10,000, I'll take 20,000 or 5,000 naira and do this. Not even killing somebody or doing anything. Please just vote for the other party. Even when your common sense is telling you that this party looks more objective and more rational. We must address the issue of poverty. The issue of poverty, we need to address it. And secondly, you see, even among educated Nigerians, I've seen people ethnicize what ordinarily should just make common sense. You know, ethnicity is so deep-rooted in us. I'm telling you honestly, I see very fine, gentle people, very fair people from one side of the country, whether from the north, from the south, and not the rest of them. When you see them take ethnic positions, sometimes you want to shake your head and say, we are in for a big trouble. They simply, not because they do not know what is right, but because of this entrenched ethnicity, they simply take a position that you know that this issue is so endemic and so entrenched that it has also been affecting us. And lastly, you see, the issue of cross-carpeting most times is among those who are vying for very high positions, elective offices, and all the rest of them.
Sorry, Ahmed, let's not keep our caller waiting for too long. Good morning, Nundi.
Good morning.
Yeah, Nundi is calling from Akwa Ibom.
Good morning, Christian Ogudu.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us.
I want to contribute in the topical issues of politicians defecting from one political party to another. I want to say it is really, really one of the political crises that is causing Nigeria to be where it is right now. I am not calling to insult anybody, but I am calling to tell the people that think that for them to be so relevant in politics is to defect to one political party to another, to desist from that act, because the act is not really helping our upcoming politicians and the upcoming leaders of Nigeria.
Thank you.
That is what I call to contribute.
Thank you very much, Ndi from Akwa Ibom. Sorry for timeout.
And lastly, we have said and we have all agreed, the stakes, the economic stake, the financial stake,
just too high.
It's too high. Except we go back to the issue of institution, because people go into politics empty, financially poor. They come out multi-billionaires and trillionaires. And we have institutions that should be able to track where these monies are coming from. And they are not doing their job. That's why politics will keep being very attractive and people will do anything. Cross carpet 100 times over and will not have any qualms. Except those institutions except they are re-engineered to do what they are supposed to do to such an extent that politics becomes an avenue for service, not an avenue for money making. Cross carpeting will not end, because the cross carpet simply to partake of the national kick.
So the political okay, we got Ate from Plateau State. Good morning. That's crossing over from south to the north central.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Yeah, welcome to Core Digest. Tell us, what are your thoughts on the issue of political cross carpeting?
I have to say we are really doing a good job, sir, and the gentlemen that are sitting there.
Thank you.
Yeah. The problem about this cross carpeting issue, really, when you look at it, you see that our politicians don't even have shape. Most of them don't have shape. Because even if you see the past administration, the people that have more of the high appointment in PDP, they have collected their pay. Now they have gone back to the APC because the administration period is over. And I am telling you, if the APC should have any problem today, I don't want to call names, but tomorrow, early in the morning, you will find them in another party that they are going to have a soup that will have a lot of palm oil again. So these people don't have shame. But for the legal practitioner, he's saying everything straight, but you should be more open. Because like the preachers, like the pastors in the churches, you have to tell them the way they will understand. Because if you read it for them, it's like you are keeping their things hiding. They don't have shame. Just tell them truth.
All right. Thank you very much, Ate. Ate called in from North Central Nigeria, Plateau State and the rest. He's putting it squarely on the lack of integrity, lack of morals and the rest. And some school of thought to say in politics there is no morals, but this discussant here, you've not agreed that there must be morals, because the purpose of holding political office or offices is or are strictly for leadership purposes. Do we have such role models in Nigeria that we can point to?
Yeah, they are bound. They are bound. I'm a student of Nigeria as a young man. I want to go to the southeast.
Mm.
Fine gentleman.
Fantastic.
An architect.
Mm.
Vice president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Mm.
Went into politics and came back poorer. That's from the southeast.
Even President Shagari.
Shehu Shagari as of today.
You must mention him.
You can't. He was never faulted.
Mm-mm.
He might be weak in terms of not having the ability to control, to have control over his cabinet.
Mm.
But no one has been able to say he stole money.
Or point to one company
that he has. If you go to the southwest, a Latif Jakonde is there. Go to his house in Ilukweju.
Oh yes. He still lives amongst the people.
Still riding one old car.
Mm.
Michael Adekule Ajasin is there.
Mm.
Ibalarebe Musa,
he's still there.
He's still there.
Yeah.
Who had every opportunity to have hobnobbed with the powers that be and also partake, was removed in 1979.
Yes.
As the first civilian governor that was impeached because of ideological difference.
Absolutely.
Not because he was corrupt.
No.
He was booted because he simply was not aligning to. I get my point.
Yeah, but let's quickly take Mohammed from the nation's capital, Abuja. Mohammed, good morning.
Hey, good morning.
Yeah, sorry for keeping you waiting that long. Yeah, tell us, what are your feelings and position about the issue, the topic of discussion?
The odd people that are talking that Buhari is not doing anything, I don't blame them, but because
they don't know how politicians is. But me, as I did, I see the work of Buhari well, well. He is trying for his work.
Okay. Well, Buhari as a politician, at least you can see that he's working very well, and the rest, you know. You want to, yeah.
I'm just saying, a mechanical who is there. These are fine
gentlemen.
That, you know, and there's this other retired colonel from the north, Abubakar Umar.
Oh, Umar, still a farmer. Yeah.
A fine, he's a prince. These are guys, these are men that ordinarily, if they want to share in the booty of Nigeria, but look at, he had to opt out of the military because of principle.
Yeah.
You might not agree with him, but he broke away from his ideological mentor. I say no. Annulling the June 12th election was something that I think was not in the best interest of Nigeria. And on that basis, he left the military.
And he resigned.
He resigned. It's an honorable. You may not, you know, the June 12th Wahala, there are two schools of thought.
Yeah.
Some believe, no, the annulment was okay. Some believe it was. But for a man to stand for his conviction and decide to sacrifice his own comfort,
going against the institution.
Institution, because if you have
that's the issue of institution you've been talking about.
The courage sometimes to just stand.
Ordinarily, it's mutiny. It would have been executed. And he said, "I can die, but because I don't believe in this position."
Are you getting my point? Those are the kind of men, and they are bound in numbers in all institutions. They are bound all over. We just pray for God to create the enabling environment for such people.
They don't come, don't see them in the political arena.
Yes, we must constantly encourage such people, because sometimes it takes courage for us to look at those who are hawks.
Where are they going to get the kind of money, the kind of horrendous billions to spend for elections? Where would they get it from?
Sir, you will go back to the drawing board, because my own belief is this. Yes, we play money politics, but I tell you, there is a way you can actually strategize, not necessarily with policy. If you have a long range, long term approach to this issue, because ultimately it's about impacting people, it's about having followership, it's about positive influence. And if you have an idea, there's a way you can actually adopt an intellectual approach and circumvent these people. You can outwit them. That's the honest truth. That's my belief. That's my conviction. That you see, the revolution that will actually usher in the most efficient system in Nigeria will be an intellectual coup d'etat. Yes. The intellectual class must come together and decide to say, look, we need to take these guys out who don't have any idea of what it means to govern a nation.
We had that movement, you know, between that June crisis, you know, the June 12th crisis and the rest. I think it's professionals, something about business professionals and the rest, and they were meeting, and you know, but all that is gone now. Let's join quickly Sunday from Mina. Good morning, Sunday.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, a million apologies for keeping you waiting there. Please tell us very quickly, what are your thoughts about our topic today?
Thank you, sir. So, I want to contribute about politicians moving from the party where they are to another one.
Yeah, go ahead.
It was very bad character for me to say. So I would like to say that they should make it constitutional. I know that politicians is one of the things. They should make it constitutional. That any member that leaves the party to another one, that should not come back. So that's why we make a set of it. Because some people that leave their party to another one, when they know what is happening to the other party, they will take it to the other one. Then it will now become an issue between the other party and the other one. They should make it a constitutional.
Okay, thank you.
Now, also, I want to contribute about our leader. Our leader has no listening ear. So, in the issue of threat crisis, you know, getting to
but, harmony. But that's not the issue we are discussing now. Sorry, Sunday. We aren't going to allow that, you know. It's not what we're talking about. Emmanuel, you want to come in now. I just wanted what Sunday said. I just wanted a legal opinion here that it won't hold water, Abbas.
I am, if you ask me, I belong to the school of thought that holds dearly the fact that we do not need too many more laws and too many more legislation. The ones we have are already more than sufficient. Oftentimes, I tell people anywhere I go, there's nothing FCC is doing that the police could not have done.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing ICPC is doing that the police could not have done.
Absolutely.
You set up an institution and you went to the police force to put almost 99% of their workforce to come. Meanwhile, you set up EFCC because the police were actually not efficient in fraud-related matters and all the rest of them. So what it is not duplication of agencies, all the rest of them. It is that even the ones we have...
Even the EFCC.
Even the ones we have, how effective
have they been?
Are we enforcing them? We have laws to address all myriads of issues that is actually facing us. But the question is enforcement.
Absolutely.
So it's not making another constitutional law. It's just you also being able to play your own little role.
As a voter.
Yes, as a voter. Look, for example, the last governorship and the presidential election, I registered where was quite different from my residence. In order for me to be able to vote in both governorship, I had to sleep in a hotel near my office. And I paid almost 18,000 naira to just exercise my vote.
I told people,
I'm passionate about electing the leadership of any society is like the pilot of a plane. If there's something wrong with that pilot, everybody's life is in jeopardy.
Absolutely.
So I take it seriously and I will go to any extent to exercise my voting right.
Okay. Emmanuel, you want to, let's start rounding up. You understand which way forward, how can such menace be checked?
Somebody have said that they lack integrity. They are shameless when they jump from one political party to another. Secondly, I want to re-emphasize that there are men whose primary responsibility, I want to hold the religious leaders responsible for lack of commitment.
Because we have an international call here from Ghana. Joseph, good morning. We lost it. So you're putting the blame squarely on the doorsteps of religious leaders?
Now, because we have audience. Now, the religious leaders, but whichever arm of religion they are, should stand for the truth and criticize or say vehemently that this is evil, that this lacks moral standard. It's basic, it's fundamental. Now, we are talking of corruption. This is one of the symbols of corruption, ability to change shape and change color overnight without good reason. Chameleon nature, it's one of the signs and symbols of corruption, because you are changing. Today you say no, tomorrow you say yes. So we have to go back to the drawing board, educate ourselves. We have to go back to the board, teach ourselves. And individuals, Nigerians themselves, are the product of what we are seeing even in leadership. When a simple person, a father in the house, cannot say the simple truth, somebody, a leader in the village, cannot say the simple truth. So the thing revolves around us. And so we welcome somebody that comes in with a big car the very moment he goes out, he goes to Abuja, comes in with money, we receive him. And so the next person says, oh, this is the intern. So he goes up, he jumps up, he collects it, he comes back again. We share the loot. And so nobody is there standing for the truth. My learned friend said, yet they are bound. The truthful guides, the men and women that could be saying the truth, seem to be gagged because the pressure is much. But I want to encourage every good Nigerian here, wherever you are, to stand up for the truth. When people start jumping from one area to the other, rebuke them openly, deny their vote, stand against this hunger. And if people are educated also, they will be able to stand against hunger. Yes, I understand that hunger can make some people to begin to lie. But if you have fundamental principles, if somebody is calling from Cross River, but if we have fundamental principles, look, we should be able to say, let's empower our people.
All right. If we have fundamental principles, you should be empowered. You want to round up now, you know, on the topic.
I will align myself with him by just re-echoing what Martin Luther King Jr. said.
Mm.
He said, where we stand in times of crisis, that is actually what determines greatness. We must admit that Nigeria is in a moral crisis.
Sorry.
And that we should not stand aloof. We must take side with the good. Because there's no middle line between lie, and truth. There's no middle line between good and bad. It's either your each side. And we need to be on the side of good. And another man said that this world is wicked. It's evil. He said this world is evil. Not because of the wickedness of evil men. He said because of the silence of good people. Those whose conscience has been sanctified by God to know what is good should not keep silence. And when they have the opportunity, they should act in the best interest of the society.
Thank
you. And that's how this society will get better.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And for you out there, if you see what is white, call it white. You see what is black, say it is black. There will always be a black sheep in the gathering, but that black sheep must be spotted and spotted on time. Reverend gentleman, Emmanuel Chukwe Emeka, thank you very, very much for being part of this program.
Thank you very much.
And my friend, as usual, a real fiery rights activist, legal practitioner, Abbas Ahmed. I'm sure maybe one of these days we'll probably be seeing you in the political turf. It will be interesting. How you survive the kind of political conflagration that engulfs this country every now and again.
You will survive the terrain because you have come out of some trenches before the time passed.
Well, I'm sure you're gathering some students already. Those who belong to your school of thought.
Correct.
Thanks very much, Abbas Ahmed, and it's always a pleasure, you know, having you with us in the studios. And to you all out there, both our callers within and outside Nigeria, let your calls keep coming in. And tomorrow is another day on Call Digest, where I'll be your anchor again. My name is Christian Ogodo. Thanks so very much for being with us today. Bye-bye.
Is it what crazy?
Or talk crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, driving looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said, oh, help
on
me.
On Call Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.